Welcome back to our Power Breakfast interview. This morning, we want to focus on something that is stirring public interest. The Coalition for Reform and Democracy has stirred the public's interest, controversy, opposition, support with the series of rallies that they're holding across the country, especially within the city, culminating in this weekend's massive rally at the KICC to welcome back the CORD leader, Raila Odinga. Joining us in the studio this morning is the spokesman of CORD in these rallies, Farah Maalim, former Deputy Speaker. Karibu bwana.
That's right.
Let's start with these rallies. What is the objective of this new awakening?
New impetus.
New awakening. What are you about?
Kenyans were complaining very hard about us just about a month ago, month and a half ago, that we're too silent. And the opposition is not playing its role. And the role of the opposition is basically to hold the government of the day responsible and for its actions and inactions. There are too many things that are happening in the country, and we feel it's time we came out. First and foremost, we feel that there is so much impunity, so much tribalism, so much discrimination and division of the society itself, so much corruption in the country. The earlier we come out to raise these issues, the better.
So you are just raising the issues in public rallies, or you're taking any other measures, or petitioning the government, or communicating in any other forums apart from the rallies that we are seeing, which people say are inciting?
No, this is not an incitement. As a matter of fact, much as we and many people in the country are convinced that we did not lose fairly last time, that we were rigged out, we still went ahead and gave the government the benefit of doubt and said the country is bigger than us. Let us allow the Jubilee government time for them to try and put things right here.
Right.
We don't see that happening right now. We see the society getting more and more divided, along all lines, along religious lines, along ethnic lines and tribal lines. We see corruption becoming runaway with all the things that are there, the SGR, the laptop issues, the NSSF issue, which was there the other day on also, and too many other things. So what we're seeing is that if we allow these things to go on without us playing our legitimate role as an opposition coalition, we will not be doing the right justice and service to the country as it is today.
But is this what Kenyans asked for?
The economy.
When they said you were quiet, you're doing nothing, you
but need basically
to
what they wanted us
is
to
this
do
what,
is yes,
this your
yes,
answer
yes,
to
yes.
their question?
Yeah, yeah. The answer right. is that we will interrogate the actions of the government. We will interrogate the actions of the government.
But what you're doing, I don't know whether it's the right place. I mean, you're going to slums where people are poverty stricken. Mathare, Kibra, and that is what is leading people to say is incitement.
No, no. Those people who live in Mathare and people who live in Kibra are Kenyans. They're entitled to a decent life. They're entitled. They're entitled to be heard. They're entitled to a better and more prudent expenditure of the taxpayers' money to try and bring them out of that poverty. But right now, we're paying billions and billions of Kenya shillings to funny things in some cases. For example, right now we have paid 1.4 billion shillings to Anglo Leasing. We never got anything for it. This is just a breach of contract. And we want to believe that the fact that we've lost the case is not entirely.
I don't know if you're accurate, because when Jay Muturi came here, he told us that they were supplied, the goods were supplied, but they overpriced.
They supplied the bandwidth.
By far.
And
yeah,
they
by far.
Supplied VSAT equipment.
Yeah. That, there are 18 contracts.
The only challenge is that this was overpriced.
Yeah, yeah. The thing is that we thoroughly overpriced, extremely overpriced.
Yeah, yeah.
The right thing that should have been done at the time was to go ahead and follow up these things to find out exactly why they were priced and who was paid what, and people to be brought to book. At that time, if you remember very well, that's the time when we were told by the former Minister for Justice and Constitutional Affairs, Kiraitu Murungi, that Anglo Leasing was a crime that never was.
Yeah, yeah.
You see what I mean?
I get it.
But everything is shrouded in such. We're not saying Amos Wako cannot be investigated. What we are saying is that when these things happen, we want the government to investigate, to bring the people, the perpetrators of these things, to book, to have a very honest, genuine effort on the part of the government to try and save the taxpayers' money. When we see what we assume to be a collision between the people who are claiming the money on a breach of contract and the government itself, in the manner that we have defended our own cases here. And the thing itself is endless, Pete.
All right.
Just paid 1.4 billion shillings. Supposed to be paid another, how much?
3.5 more billion.
Perhaps even 5 more billion.
And how many more? How many are like that, that are basically also in the pipeline that are coming in?
The question that I think you have not answered in my mind is, how does what you're doing address the failures of government? What do you intend to achieve by what you're doing?
You see,
versus objectives. That's what I'm trying to.
You see, let me tell you one thing. Democracy, as bad as it is, one would want to see it, is nonetheless. But it's the only thing we have right now, and the most popular system of governance in the world. So when you see all the stuff that the American Senate, from the Republicans and the Democrats, the Republicans in the Senate and in the House of Representatives, go toe-to-toe with Obama.
Yes.
In the manner he's executing the policies, including the so-called Obamacare and others.
Yeah.
And you see the same things also between the Tories and the Labour, or the coalition of the Tories, the Lib Dem.
Yeah.
You see what I mean?
Yes.
I mean, you don't expect the rules of engagement in our case to be determined always by the whims of the political class at that time, or the elite for that matter, to say that, yeah, these problems are there with the government, but for God's sake, don't talk about them.
Okay.
Are you getting my point? So we are an opposition right now.
Yes.
We want to capture power.
Yes.
Any opportunity in which the government mismanages the affairs of the country is a golden opportunity for us to ride on.
Okay.
But we will do all these things within the framework, within the ambit of the constitution itself. The law.
Okay, fine. Let's be systematic again. Mm. What is your plan? What are you doing?
Well, you see, you don't expect us to tell you all our plans.
You are doing rallies? No. I mean, the country is old. You owe the country and your supporters some clear plan of action.
Frankly.
You are rabble-rousers trying just to start a sentiment against the government.
No, that's what I'm saying.
What are you planning to do? You have outlined the problems that you have with the government.
Yes.
So you say, we are doing this rally, then we are doing this rally, and then we want at the end of this rally, or we want to use this rally to do this. You see,
our plan is one.
Yes.
It's only this kind of pressures that the government of the day will stop acting with impunity.
Okay.
This country is divided. It's divided 50-50 between URP and TNA, which in effect, by and large, in the interpretations of the eyes of Kenyans, is only a part of the country. The greater part of the country has been marginalized and literally kept out of the loop in terms of service delivery, in terms of employment, in terms of everything. It's coming not even from us. It's not coming even from us. It's coming from how many non-Rift Valley and mountain people have lost their jobs in big parastatals in the country now for a while? Many of them. But then how many times do people come out there and say, oh, so and so should not lose? Look at what's happening right now in the saga of Iron Way Guru and Rugut.
Yeah,
it's them actually who are saying that this is never, it's no longer a fair distribution of the national cake between ourselves. We agreed on 50-50. The mountain is taking more than us. You know what I mean? And you're talking about Rift Valley, not even the whole of Rift Valley. So basically what I'm trying to tell you is that
that's only one person.
No. It's listen. It doesn't matter, Mutegi, how much you. If the whole of the nation, the 44 million Kenyans today, make up their mind and say that this thing is black and it's only white and green, and it never changes that. Everybody knows what's happening in the country. We're getting divided and more divided. Tribalism is setting its ugly face again in a manner never experienced for God knows, I think, since the 70s. The manner in which the public resources is being used also doesn't show any prudence. This is a country that is one of the most unequal countries in the world. Unequal in the sense that the rich are extremely rich.
That's true.
And the poor are extremely poor.
The statistics attest to that.
The statistics is a common knowledge. It's not something that Farah is saying or anybody else is saying.
Yeah.
So what needs to be done is that this government must be jolted back into some sense.
Yeah.
Because it's all about grabbing now.
Okay, you said you, of course, you're in the opposition, and the objective of the opposition is to get power.
Yes.
All right. How do you want to get power? Within, well, within the next next elections, you want to push the government to be
no. Listen,
out of power, or you want to push the government to act in a certain manner and to do things that you want.
Let me tell you one thing, David Makari. This country almost became a failed state in 2007-2008.
Yes.
After the elections, because of a miscarriage of justice in the way the election itself was prosecuted, or the results were tallied and prosecuted.
Right.
Exactly the same, if not worse, happened again in 2013. We said, as a coalition, the country is bigger than us. Let us allow this information to become a matter of public domain.
Yes.
And let it take its own time. Today, I think more Kenyans and more people outside the country are convinced that these elections were not done in the best possible manner.
Right.
Right now, what we are asking for ourselves are a number of things. One, we want to seek that frugality and the prudence in the manner the public resources are utilized in the country. We don't want these mega projects that are driven more than anything else by corruption than anything else. You have a standard gauge which was supposed to go for 220 something billion shillings, now it's gone to 400 something billion shillings. And we are told it cannot be given through due diligence because it's government to government. A government to government, if it's an aid or a grant, then you can talk about it and say, look, the Chinese are paying for it. They're not asking us for any money. Yeah. If they want to give it to their own companies and they want to give it for an inflated price, so what do we care ourselves? You know what I mean?
Yes.
But here is money we are going to pay. Generations to come, Kenyans are going to pay for it.
Yeah.
We had the laptop issue, which basically right now, because of the competition within the elite, the eating elite within Jubilee itself,
yes,
ends up in court now. It's nothing to do with the rest of the country. It's just like, no, it has to be done more fairly between us, because we are the ones who are together as a coalition or as a group, in the manner you want to divide it. Let's be honest and fair about these things. And many more are happening. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And some have happened, including, Kenyans are just beginning.
All right. Well spoken, Farah, but you have not answered my question.
Which is?
Are you trying to get this, shorten this government's time?
Two things. No. We have absolutely.
Well, which you can do. I mean, there's nothing unconstitutional about it.
I'm getting
you.
It's
possible you can get the government, you can get the president impeached, you can have a government before 5 years. Or are you trying to push the government to do some things?
Well,
while it continues
both things. Well, some of us are convinced. You see, I was here with you the other day here. We were talking about the xenophobia on Somalis and what's happening to Somalis.
Yes.
And I remember telling you, there's going to be a massive economic cost to it. We had thousands upon thousands of Somalis who are living in here, who are going to our good cost, high cost schools, who are spending inside the country $120 million a month, coming in from remittances. These guys were never giving us problems with our employment. You never see a Somali going around looking for jobs. Because these are all people who settled in Western Europe and settled in America and Australia and want their children to grow up in an environment that is African, that is Somali. That's why they brought them here, to go to the high cost schools in here. The kind of things that were done to them, which was criminal in a sense, seriously criminal.
Mm.
What is the consequence right now, and the effect is that the bulk of them have left the country. Many of them are living, and they're being welcomed with open arms by Uganda, by Rwanda, by Mozambique, by all countries in the continent, because they will help them spur their own economy and spur growth in there. Today, you can see the paper central bank governor is trying to allay the jitters of Kenyans that the shilling is taking a free fall. It's going to take, there's no question about that, some of these things, because it's a supply and demand. The more dollars you have,
yes,
the more the demand for the shilling is.
That's true.
The less the dollars you have, the more the problem gets compounded. So the economy is definitely doing poorly. We are living in here. We're bringing up, we're here. We can't go anywhere else.
Yes.
Me and you are living in here. We don't want to get into a situation in which when you have to pay for the fees of your child who is in Europe, yeah, or in America, you're going to pay twice what you're paying today. I have children outside. I have a son who goes to school in Holland. I have a son who goes to school in Turkey, and I make payments from here. And, you know, this kind of thing. So we have to talk about these things well in advance.
Right.
Insecurity is there.
Yeah.
The insecurity, we don't have a government that's doing enough about
and
insecurity.
And your chosen platform. So the objective, of course, you have dodged to answer that question twice. You have not said what you objectively, you know, want to do. So you want the government to fix this problem.
We objectively want, yes. Of course, yes.
Yeah.
Of course, yes. You know, that's the role of opposition, by the way. Yeah. That's the role. The role of opposition is to punch holes in the mistakes of the government itself.
Yes.
In the plans of the government, when there's need to punch those holes,
right,
so that when the government is able to change its course,
yes,
and deal with these things, because the country is ours, by the way, if it becomes a failed state, it becomes a failed state for everybody. We want to, we are in the political game and we want to take over power come 2017,
right?
Not before that,
yes, also 2017,
yeah, 2017, yes,
okay.
In any case, we have, but everything you're seeing right now,
yeah, is to popularize your agenda.
Not only to popularize our agenda, no, to bring out the real salient issues that need to be brought out in this
country. And your chosen platform is the political rallies.
Because engaging the Jubilee government is like talking to this wall. It never changes anything. I've talked here from your own, how many times did I talk about the security issue? You remember last time I told you, there's only one Somali speaking officer gathering intelligence information from the so-called where Al-Shabaab information can be found in Isli, and the same thing in the refugee camps. Nothing has changed. It's still the same.
Okay.
You see what I mean?
Yeah.
These are the kind of things that,
okay.
So it's like I was one person who was talking to the director of intelligence as often as I can.
All right.
It's only the last time when we talked, and we literally, I told him, I you know, what, for whatever reasons,
yes,
you people don't want to fight terrorism in the country. For whatever reasons. My conclusion of your actions and the inability for you to respond to some of these things is that you have no interest. But before that, Michael Gishangi is a good friend of mine, and we used to communicate.
So you are doing these rallies.
They're called Okoa
Kenya.
Okoa Kenya, yes, because we don't want Kenya to die. I mean, we want Kenya to...
But how do you Okoa Kenya through public meetings, public rallies? You know?
Well, I think what we're doing right now is... by the way, that is a very proper democratic process. We don't have the powers now. When we want to change the government position, people demonstrate in the streets. People go out in rallies. People bring out the issues. People come and engage in such talk shows.
Okay.
And those are pressures, basically, on the government. We are not the government.
All right. So what should Kenyans expect?
Those rallies generate into violence?
They can't generate into violence. Against who? Against who?
Against shops?
No. They can't generate into violence.
So far, nothing has happened. Okay. But so you're sure that nothing will generate?
Absolutely. Absolutely. We believe in the rule of law ourselves.
Okay.
I am one person who believes in the rule of law. I don't believe in anybody taking the law into his own hands in any way.
So,
I don't believe in accessing power in this country through the back door. You know what I mean?
All right.
We don't.
So you are here. Yes. So you guys have held the rallies in Mlolongo, in Babadogo, in Kibera. Where next? And
there's one on Friday in Mombasa, but the main one is going to be here in KCC on Saturday when the coalition leader comes back.
Yes.
Yeah.
This is billed as a homecoming, and somebody's saying, so what? I mean, Raila has been in the U.S.
for 3 months.
Life goes on. So what is the big deal?
For 3 months.
Yes.
Yeah, but he's a coalition leader.
Yes.
He has not been fighting for freedom for us like Jomo Kenyatta. When Jomo Kenyatta was fighting in Europe, he's just having a private life.
Where did he fight for freedom in this country, Jomo Kenyatta? Just give me exact dates and when and where.
He was sent there.
And we know he went to detention. He was sent there.
He
was married there. He lived in that place. He talked in Trafalgar Square many times. I know that, yes. And he wrote Facing Mount Kenya. When he came in here, he did a lot of work on the education sector, which is, I commend him for it in a big way. He went to detention for how many years?
Yes.
It's about 9 years, am I right?
Yes.
Raila has been in detention for 9.5 years.
Yeah.
You get my point?
So there's moderation.
Of course. Nobody has suffered
it's
for
like
this.
Kenyatta now coming back.
Nobody has suffered for this. Why do you think only Kenyatta can be Kenyatta, or we cannot have any other Kenyatta? You think the fact that this kind of status can only be claimed by only... I think Raila has done more for this country than anybody else in post-independence. I don't want in any way devalue what Kenyatta has done. He's the first president of this country, and he's done a lot of work on the land rights, the Kikuyu land rights, that's there in history. He has basically, and that's the whole idea, he went to UK the first time. And of course, he did a lot. I mean, on whether he did as much as a president in this country is a matter that's out there for public debate. I'm one of those guys who thinks that the dividing of our country started at that time, that he more or less did not run the country in the equality that we all expected him to do.
Don't you think
we supported him? My community supported Kenyatta in a measure that nobody else has supported, let me tell you. And the Mau Mau struggle, nobody talks about it. Nobody talks about the role of the Somalis in the Mau Mau fight, except the late Mariama and Baimunge. Those are the guys who, these are the guys we, our businessmen, our traders in all parts of the country here used to take the Winchester guns and all those guns to them and take money to them and take money to the freedom fighters in those days. So there are many unsung heroes in that. And I think if you look at KCA, you know, what was called the KCA was a party.
Yeah.
The young man on the left side is a Somali, is a Kenyan Somali. The first Muslim to go to Alliance High School.
Yes.
Their property was confiscated just outside here, in Juja area. Yeah. And including their own coffee farm was confiscated by the British because of the things they did. But some of you want to claim that the struggle, the first political detainee in Kenya was a Somali. Read the book which is written by Wanyiri Kioro.
Yes.
Why is this very mischievous conspiracy to try and own
rewrite history?
The freedom struggle and give it only in one section of the country. I think we did as much, if not more, in some cases.
But because
people want to maintain certain monopoly on the grips of the resources of in post independence, you have to show everybody else in a different light and own that thing. No.
But people feel like the Uhuru government has given Somalias much more leeway and main position.
Listen. To begin with, the fact that
You're not happy.
No. I'm okay with the way things are, in the sense that Somalis are there as part of this country. There's no way you can wish them away. You can take them to Kasarani. You can take them to jails. You can take them to detentions. They're here to stay forever. And the more you do things, the things that were done to them, the more it makes them stronger. And the more they'll fight for their own rights in here. You see what
the
I mean?
Question I ask whether
I'm telling you. I'm telling you. But the real mistreatment of Somalis happened in this country, both under his father's guard and under Moi's guard. Like Wagala, an incident happened, the massacre of Wagala, the genocide of Wagala, the Gariza, Bula Kartasi in Gariza, the Malkamari, all this thing happened during Moi's time. The first president, Kenyatta, did a serious economic sabotage to us. He targeted us in all the urban settings so that we couldn't partake in the economic growth of the country those days in a manner beneficial to the community. Yeah. But at the same time, I must give also a lot of credit to Moi. After the 82 August coup attempt, when the constitution was saved by a Somali general, you know what I mean? Then there was a big change of heart.
Okay.
He's the one who integrated us into the mainstream of the society. You can never take that one away.
All right.
You get my point.
The
same thing. I agree with you. I mean, the leader of the majority leaders of Somalia, yes, and cabinet ministers in every position, yes. But why should somebody talk about? Why I've never seen people talk about many Luyas being in the system or many Kikuyus being in the system or many Kambas.
You are already saying the country is divided. You are not getting the fair share. Now you have contradicted yourself.
No. I'm looking at it. I'm looking at it as a coalition. I'm looking at some of the things. By the way, they are in Jubilee and in if you want to talk about the Somalis, they're more in Jubilee actually, and I'm serious in Jubilee, there's no question about that. But what I know is that there are certain areas which voted 100% code, and those areas are basically
voted 100%.
I'm talking about Kenyans at that time. I'm not talking purely on the interests of Somalis.
The lapse of project that's being mooted by the government, which is coming to sort out all that area of to set another economy in that country.
Let me tell you one thing. I was there when the Gariza Modogashe Road, the Arab Fund, the Arab Badea, the Saudis, the Kuwaitis, and all of them, P pledged money for the Garissa, the tarmacking of the Garissa, Modugashi Road, and onwards from Modugashi to Wajir and progressively all the way to Mandera. It was signed when Uhuru was the Minister for Finance. The donors have given all their money. That small component of the Kenyan side is what up to now, from 2007, when Kibaki inaugurated that road, up to now, we don't have that money. So as far as the proper infrastructural development is concerned, we're still seen as a peripheral part of the country. You get my point? We're still seen as a peripheral part of the country. Unfortunately so, even under this government. We expected a lot better than this because of the manner in which the current president as a minister for finance had promised that that will be done, and done fast.
You sent those places which are called in Northeastern. Have you just did like that?
No. We see with
not. We know you have devolution.
Mm.
So can that claim be valid?
That?
What you are saying, that court, the place which overwhelmingly vote in court.
I'm talking about the country. I'm not talking about Northeastern province in that sense.
Even them, is there
in Northeastern? No.
With the devolution, can that argument be valid?
For massive infrastructural development, yes. You don't expect the county government with 15% of the ordinary revenue divided between 47 different counties to help in making a tarmac road from Garissa to Mandera. You can't. The central government is retaining 85%. So that 85% should give us. This is the only part of the country where there's no roads. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Why are we being treated differently? If I may ask you.
I thought the programs to do that.
It's been there in the pipeline for God knows how many years, over 10 years. And I think every time they want to do it, they look for other priorities. It's not going to get into a situation when you will miss priorities of putting up roads, infrastructures in other parts of the country. And then you say, we've dealt with all the rest, now let's see if you can give these guys, these peripheral poor guys, something. But we don't have the roads there. No.
Right. Of course, there's a lot of feedback on our discussion, and somebody says, well, it's okay, every Kenyan has the freedom of expression, but some of the statements being made by politicians on the platform are further polarizing Kenyans. How is that helping?
You see, I don't like this manner in which politicians have perfected in revalidating themselves always. When I talk about you, David McCallie, as a politician, and find issues with you, yes, the politicians would want to say, translate this as, I'm saying something about Western Kenya, about Luyasi.
Mm.
That is a construct of the politicians. It's not of the Kenyans. Kenyans would want to deal with you as David McCallie, who has been given a responsibility to prosecute a certain work, and whether you do it well or you don't do it well is the issue that should be debated, should become issues of contention. But not because you come from a certain area, we are polarizing now because they are fighting me, you are fighting my community. I mean, by 22 years after the first multi-party elections in this country, Kenyans should know better than that.
Yeah.
Okay,
maybe a parting shot, last words. I mean, the rallies are going on. Your assurance is that nothing is going to be inciting, no chaos to be expected.
No.
CORD is prosecuting a peaceful agenda, performing its role.
CORD is prosecuting a peaceful agenda. It's performing its role as an opposition political party. It's also performing its role as a major contender for space in the running of this country come 2017.
Yes.
And it's also very much pained by the manner in which the taxpayers' money is being used, by the manner of insecurity in the country,
right,
which we believe the state is doing nothing against it, or rather the government of the day is doing nothing against it, by the misuse of the public resources, by the incessant divisions of Kenyans where some parts of the country feel the entitlement of the government and the rest of them should wait for their turn.
Yes.
I mean, this kind of things, which is now very divisive and very bad.
Yeah.
The manner we have more or less had the Electoral Commission, so-called independent, which is no longer any independent Electoral Commission, Electoral and Boundaries Commission running the and the way they run the last elections. I mean, we need some of those reforms like the Electoral Commission. We want it to be disbanded. We want there to be a national dialogue. We want to have a proper input of people who have no interest in that, including foreigners. You see what I mean?
Okay.
We want a newly reconstituted electoral boundaries commission.
The fact that and you yourself, your party could not hold elections.
The fact that our party could not hold elections, yes. We also are to blame in equal measure. We were not able to do that. We will put our act together. There was too much infiltration from outside.
And
the manner in which we did wasn't one of the best. Yes, we don't run away from that blame. You see what I mean? We take responsibility for it. Yeah. We accept responsibility for not having run our elections in the manner it should have been run. We'll still go ahead and do it very well.
Jubilee says they are going to, I mean, there are reports that they also plan to hold a rally on Friday to counter your streak of rallies. What do you have to say?
Be my guest. It's the constitutional right. It's there in law. It's written. Nobody can take it away from anybody.
All right. We leave it at that. Farah Maalim, the spokesman of CORD in the ongoing campaign or rallies, agitation, if we like it, trying to put the government on toes. Having rallies coming up, your take. You've had it. Thank you for watching.